Hi all. We are today discussing elections results from three northeastern states of Tripura, Nagaland and Meghalaya from Hindustan Times headquarters in Delhi. I have with me Aurangzeb Naqshbandi and Jen Jacob, who will discuss that how this dramatic win in Tripura for BJP, where the left has been routed almost after 25 years of rule, and the impact in Meghalaya with the Congress is the leading party but still very far from majority, and in Nagaland where the BJP-NDPP alliance is heading to form the next government. To start with, Jayant, because Tripura elections I think is one of the biggest surprising elections, because last time if you see the left, the vote share was 51%, though their vote share have gone down by about 8 or 9%, but they're totally wiped out in the state. So how do you perceive the BJP's performance and routing of left in Tripura?
I think it's very significant. If you look at the statistics last year, BJP contested in 50 seats. In 49, they didn't win the deposit. They had less than 2% vote. From there, the forming government in Tripura is very significant. Also, what is significant is the fact that this is the first election in India where a left government was being taken on by the rightist party, that is the BJP, and the result is there for everyone to see. So it is an ideological win for the BJP. They made an alliance which is very tactical, and their campaign was very strategic, and it worked well for them, and it's very bad news for the CPIM.
Yeah, but Tripura, Aurangzeb, one important factor is that last time the Congress got 38% votes. This time it is 1.8, less than 2. Huh? In 5 years, how the Congress pace went to the BJP, it shows a lot about how the party has been functioning.
No, this is a problem with the Congress. Wherever they cede space to any other party, they will lose that space. Tripura, they were the natural opponent, the successor to the left. They ceded the space to the BJP, and that's how BJP got, they are in power today. So wherever this happens, wherever they are willing to leave that space, whether opposition, whether ruling party, they will face the same situation.
No, but the question arises is that the BJP, the Congress MLAs, first moved to TMC and Mass, then to BJP, a large number. So wasn't the central leadership of Congress seeing that how the party is losing Tripura, they didn't do anything for?
See, Chetan, the major problem that the Congress is facing is there is organizational weaknesses all around, across the country. Now, in Tripura, they were out of power for the last 25 years.
Mm.
Now, 25 years is a big time for any party which was there. In 93, they were in power in Tripura from 88 to 93. So in 25 years, sustaining the organization is a big challenge. The workers also, after a point, they give up, they tend to move to other parties. So it is very difficult in any. See Nagaland, what happened in Nagaland? Again, they were struggling to find candidates in the initial stage. Finally, when they announced 23 candidates, out of those, they had to withdraw 5 more candidates. So ultimately, 18 were in the fray. Why? Because, again, there is organizational problem there. You don't have an organization. You don't have a party organization there. So that is the problem Congress is facing in states like Bihar, states like Tamil Nadu, and other states. Where
Uttar Pradesh also, to a large extent. Uttar Pradesh also.
Uttar Pradesh, yes. They have. That's why we saw the results that came in last year. So organizational weakness is the major problem the Congress is facing.
Is it because Northeast, if you see the elections overall, the BJP came up with a very smart strategy for the first time in Northeastern states, where they have booth levels, every voter list, guys for voter list, like in Tripura, they contacted every voter at least 5 or 6 times in the last few years. So is it something new for Indian politics, or especially even for the left, which is cadre-based party, where the cadre is very strong? So another cadre-based party taking on BJP, does it alarmist for the left parties in India?
But I think we have to look at it in two ways. Number one, I think though they are into power at center, this is a fourth year in government, they behave like an opposition party. and the Prime Minister is always in a campaign mode. So BJP is the only Indian political party which is battle ready and ready to take election, take go for election all the time. So when that happens from the top, it reaches the lowest level. So people are always ready, worker is ready, cadre is ready, that kind of a thing. But it comes to left leg, Aurangzeb was making that point, 25 years sustaining a cadre or people with you, it's not an easy thing. The way it happened in West Bengal, like Trinamool got better off left in left sound strategy, whether it is the local level politics, the good of it, the bad of it, whatever it is. But in Northeastern state, I think BJP is making a deliberate effort, and also they have an idea in 2019. They may not make the kind of impact they made in North India. So some seats from Northeast will not be a bad idea to work on.
And we have also seen in, let me add to Jens, you know, we have also seen in Northeast, whichever power is, you know, in whichever party is in power at the center, it has an advantage in Northeast because the people said it's a underdeveloped region, so they want some kind of development and they look at the center for that. So wherever, you know, we have seen it in the past also, and we might see it in future also.
Also, don't forget about the money that
money factor. As you know, Nagaland Congress president told me that in Nagaland, money factor is the biggest factor there. So it was, money is a big factor in Northeast, yes.
Nagaland is a very surprising election because NPF had been an ally of BJP for 15 years. Just before elections, they dumped Nagaland People Front and a new party was formed, NDPP, with former CM as Nifirio as the head. And the party has really done well in Nagaland. So, it also shows that the people in Nagaland have gone against the traditional Naga party.
Again, you know, it is anti-incumbency. So, when you have anti-incumbency, you always look for the best alternative. So, the best alternative was NDDP. And Congress, again, as I told you, were never in the game.
In Nagaland, they were never in the game.
So, Congress had to, they were fighting the elections but just for the sake of it. They were never serious. See, Rahul Gandhi did not visit, he did not campaign in Nagaland. No central leader went to Nagaland for campaigning or any other, for, you know, saying how the party is doing there. So there was no central intervention from the Congress. So Congress was not interested in Nagaland. And that's why BJP, as Jayant pointed out, is an election fighting machine. It is always ready to fight election. It is always there 24/7, you know, it is battle ready. So that is what they do. They go to elections with the, you know, intention of forming the government there with whatever party they decide, you know, the alliances, and then they go for it.
But Meghalaya is one state where the Congress was in power for 10 years.
Yeah.
And so far, they are the leading party there. But Aurangzeb, do you think, will they be able to cobble up the numbers form the government, or it will be like Manipur and Goa?
It is very difficult to say at this point of time, because a lot of calculations and, you know, other permutations and combination go into play. So a lot of it depends on how the regional plays now, you know, what they decide. Like Congress has rushed its senior leaders. Ahmed Patel is there, Kamal Nath is there, CP Joshi is there, Mukul Vasnik is there. So it remains to be seen how they convince the other parties to get on board and, you know, become their alliance partner.
Like, I was listening morning to Refugio. So question was asked whether horse trading is there. So he said that horse trading has reality in Northeast. So do you think in Meghalaya this horse trading or the money power will play its role?
Both of us said, money is the biggest factor in Northeast. So money power will come into play, definitely.
And always when it comes to money power, the ruling party has an obvious advantage.
Advantage.
And they also can offer other things, like offering them some ministerial
packages,
courses in the economic packages, things like that. So an opposition party, which is very poor financially, can never match the money power of a party which rules the country.
And for one thing, Jayant, nationally, what do you think, what is the significance of the results from the three northeastern states before the Karnataka polls?
But I think these are not exactly two comparable things, but I think it will be, when you think from the point of view of 2019 election, so BJP now know they can get some more seat from this area, number one. Number two, as the BJP is smart in building alliance, And whoever is willing to go with them, have supper with them, they are willing to do that. And they don't have any ideological problem with that. So they are very practical, they are very smart, and they have this killer instinct. So I think that's the larger message from these three elections.
Is it the message is that if you want to take on BJP, you will have to use BJP tactics to defeat BJP. You will have to have smart alliances, all the opposition parties coming together for 2019 elections. Then you can see some sort of an impact to challenge the BJP bandwagon.
I think so. This has to be Narendra Modi versus the rest. There is no two ways about it. Everybody is running for their lives. I'm talking about the opposition parties. If they run together, they have a chance of countering Narendra Modi.
It is also a matter of survival for them. If they don't come together, they will be finished. See what happened to Mayawati in UP. Samajwadi Party also, in the UP election. But Chetan, I would like to add one thing. Karnataka is the first major big state that goes to polls in this year. So a lot depends on Karnataka. The Congress revival at the center or in other states largely depends on Karnataka. If they retain power, it will give them a major boost, and they will also be in a position to fight Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, and Rajasthan in a better way. So Karnataka, I would say, is the big state.
Aurangzeb, there are many questions from our listeners. Jay Mohan is asking a question: if money is a factor in elections, then why did people vote for BJP in the three states?
So obviously they have more money than the other parties. It's
so then you say that the people can be bought, the voters can be bought, and the money plays an extremely important role in winning elections apart from strategy.
It's not really about money winning you votes. It's like money helps you campaign better, money helps you reach out to people in a better way. So money doesn't mean that you go and pay 5,000 rupees and people give you votes. So in that point of view, I think BJP has all the advantages that any political party can have in this country now. So they are making use of it.
Yeah.
Aurangzeb, you raised the point about Karnataka elections.
Yes.
This year, Karnataka is the one big election that is coming in May, most likely. And then there will be the BJP rule states, where the BJP has been in power for a long time, like Chhattisgarh for almost 15 years, Madhya Pradesh almost 15 years, Rajasthan one term, in Rajasthan where they have lost all the three bipoles. So
even in Madhya Pradesh.
Yeah, even in the Madhya Pradesh, they have lost four bipoles so far. So how you have been saying that Karnataka can set a trend for 2019. How do you think Karnataka will set a trend?
I would add that, all elections are important. There's no doubt about that, but I was saying that Karnataka is the big state. Being a big state, a lot of there's a lot at stake for the Congress. Why? Because if Congress is able to retain that, they will be back in the reckoning. There, it will start the process of revival for the party. So Congress is very crucial for them. Retaining Karnataka is the ultimate goal, and the way Rahul Gandhi is going there, he's again going there on 20th of this month. He will be there for 4 days. So the way he is campaigning there also shows the seriousness on the part of the Congress to retain Karnataka, which we didn't see in Northeast. I told you he didn't go to...
He didn't go. He had only one rally
in
Tripura and few in Meghalaya.
Two in Meghalaya or three in Meghalaya. Yeah. So, and the way he is going to Karnataka is again, it shows the kind of, the significance they attach to the state. So after Karnataka, then there will be three big states, as you said, Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan. Rajasthan, we have seen, how the bipoles have, given Congress an edge, and also set the trend that, we might have a Congress government in November, December, whenever the elections are held. So, Madhya Pradesh, again, anti-incumbency factor will be there. Fatigue factor will be there, because it's been, Chhattisgarh, same thing, fatigue.
15 years,
So, a lot depends on, as I said, Karnataka will set the trend, and it will, then... these states will add, and finally we go to 2019,
big election. But Jayant in Karnataka, do you think Yedurappa is the face, he is the former chief minister, though there are charges of corruption against him. Is Congress on the weak wicket in Karnataka, or the BJP will not be able to trounce an ace politician like Siddaramaiah?
Well, I think Congress is on a better wicket in Karnataka, if not a good wicket, so to speak. But Yediyurappa being the same face of BJP in Karnataka is not a great news for many people, including some of the party workers, leaders, etc. Because he has this corruption charge and there is an image issue there. And also you are up against a very smart regional leader like Siddaramaiah, who knows how to play politics on multiple fronts. So I think Congress has a reasonable advantage there. Like Arunse was saying, also don't forget the fact that Karnataka is one state where it is Congress taking on BJP. It's a two parties taking on each other, most of it. So this will be harbinger of election in other states where there are similar kind of fights, be it Madhya Pradesh, be it Rajasthan, where these two national parties are coming.
And one more thing that I would like to add is, in BJP, you will see there is also a lot of infighting happening, which is not the case with Congress this time. Because you have a strong leader there in Siddaramaiah, and you know the Congress has also, Rahul Gandhi has also given, you know, has handed over the state to him. Virtually, you know, he's deciding about the strategy, candidates, everything. On the other hand, there is a lot of infighting in the BJP. Yeah. So that is also putting the BJP at a disadvantage. I don't know how they will be able to counter that.
No, but if you see from the reports we read, the BJP strategy, now the BJP is projecting Prime Minister Narendra Modi as a face. Yediyurappa will not be the face of the campaign. So, and as the central leaders have gone there, they have deputed them for different tasks in Karnataka. So, doesn't it appear that the BJP has realized that the Yediyurappa factor is not doing anything for them?
But Chetan, as we have seen in the past, in big states, people want to see who is their face. What happened to Congress in Gujarat? If they had a good face, a credible face, the elections would have there would have been a different elections. So the people, they know that Modi is the Prime Minister of the country. He cannot come and govern the state. So they want a credible local face.
Aurangzeb, Gujarat and Karnataka are different in one way, because Gujarat is home state of...
No, I am saying the polity of this nation is also changing. The people want to see who is going to be their Chief Minister or their Prime Minister. That is how 2014 election played, you know, the way it played, you know, it turned out to be.
But Jayant, one message which I can get from Northeast is that Northeast was a state where the BJP didn't have any sort of a footprint before 2014. But then they were Assam, then other states, Manipur, and now the three Northeastern states.
Let me correct you. They did not win Manipur. They did not win Arunachal Pradesh. It was...
They are in power. But they have footprint in all the Northeastern states now. So does it give a message? Because now for more than 20 states, the BJP is in power directly or indirectly. So does it give a message to the country that BJP is the party which is for future in the country and all the opposition parties are nowhere close by?
So I think message is very strong there. For example, last time it happened was when I think Indira Gandhi was the Prime Minister, like more than 18 states with one party.
They have surpassed Indira Gandhi's
number now. But at the same time, Northeast, you have to take into account so many factors, including the way Congress treated Hemant Biswal. So you look at what is he doing since then. So he has proved to be a pan-Northeast leader. So he's everywhere and he's making inroads, stitching up things for the BJP, etc., etc. But I think having 20 seats at your kitty, but I don't think national election 2019 will be an aggregate of all these things we have talked about. It can be a different election altogether.
And I think in 2019, the 5 years of Modi government, anti-incumbency will be against him. He cannot speak like an opposition leader anymore in 2019.
Yes, and they will be tested on the governance they did during the past 5 years. So that will be a big factor there that time.
But do you think Aurangzeb, is Congress prepared for 2019?
I see no reason not to believe that. Yes, they are. They are the main opposition party. They have to be ready. They have to be. And the way Rahul Gandhi has been leading the campaign and other, I think.
Elections are just not won because of the campaign. Like if you see Gujarat, the second phase they lost, it was because of the organizational weakness of the Congress.
That I pointed out that yes, Congress has this problem. The organizational weakness is there. But since you have a new president now, he has new ideas. New style of functioning, so he definitely has a big challenge ahead. that is reviving the organization in all these states across the country and get back the Congress back to the
feet. My question is, will the Congress or the United Opposition be able to take very efficient BJP's election machinery, which have been winning them elections across states, except Bihar? They have won almost every state.
They don't have any option. They have to come together. The biggest strategy would be to bring all opposition parties under one platform, one roof. That will be the biggest. So once you are able to do that, it's half work half done. If you are not able to do that, then once you are spread across, the BJP will finish you.
Yeah, Jayant, I have one question on Kerala. Like, they have made a lot of noises in Tripura. The BJP is also making a lot of noises in Kerala. Oh, maybe over tenor killings, other issues. So, what sort of, after Tripura, the BJP, the left have only one state left, that is Kerala. So, will BJP able to make some sort of impact in Kerala in next 2019 elections?
No, I don't think these are two comparable things. For the simple fact that the Congress votes in 2013, it didn't go to Congress, it went to BJP, we can safely assume. That is not the case in Kerala to begin with. Number one, Congress is still a strong party. It has grassroots level leaders, it has a certain vote percentage. So Kerala still remains a safe place for Congress party, number one. Number two, BJP doesn't have the critical mass. For example, unless they have a critical mass among the Hindu votes, I don't think they can swing more than one or two seats, which is the case anyway now.
I should thank both Aurangzeb and Jayant for a very interesting discussion on today's election results. Please share this video and join us later. Thanks a lot.